Hello, this is Pastor Michael Eaton, the senior pastor of the Bethlehem Baptist Church here in Paul's Valley, Oklahoma. And today I want to announce the release of The Secret to Your Best Life, the workbook, Understanding the Will of God Through the Word of God. And we'd like you to pick up a copy of this handy workbook with the new scan technology. So you can go through the book, The Secret to Your Best Life, learn God's plans, preparation, products, and path, and purpose for your life. And also, you can use the scan technology to go into a deeper understanding through watching videos and listening to MP3 file sermons to help bring out a better understanding while you're taking notes as well in The Secret to Your Best Life, the workbook. So we want you to pick this up, and they will be available within major bookstores in about 6 weeks. It's already available now on Amazon.com, and we'd just love for you to pick up a copy as well as Kindle. So we'd love for you to pick up a copy of The Secret to Your Best Life, Understanding the Will of God Through the Word of God, the workbook edition with the new scan technology. I don't believe that this technology is being used to teach the Word of God anywhere else. So get this book and also pick up other books that I have available. The regular Secret to Your Best Life, just the regular book, as well as How to Choose a Worthy Mate. And if you're going to be a part of my class entitled The Effective Bible Reader, pick up that before you come to class on Amazon.com. So we want to thank you for listening. May God bless you and keep you, is my prayer.
Indeed, encouraging to see the back work of what we need to do.
Amen.
To build this edifice.
Yes.
What we see in the survey, we need everybody.
Yes. Everybody.
To pray.
Amen.
Amen.
We need everybody.
Everybody.
To give.
Amen.
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 Amen. And gave an example of Sister Baby Ruth. Everybody can give something.
Amen. Amen.
She made a commitment for her and her husband and kept it. So we all can give something.
All right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Bethlehem,
share what?
How are we going to share it?
By living it and giving it.
Amen. By living it and giving it. We're going to be looking at a message this morning entitled How to Make the Right Choices in Life. We're going to look at Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 3. Please stand in reverence to the Word of God. Stand symbolically saying that I will stand on the Word of God. I believe it's two slides. Let's read it on three. One, two, three.
Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod, the tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I had called them. So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off.
Amen. You may be seated.
Amen.
In the household of the Lord, and again, we're talking about how to make the right decisions in life. How to make the right decisions in life. We're going to talk about this morning the praise of choices. We're going to talk about the prayer of choices. We're going to talk about the placing of choices. We want Christians to know tonight, today, that Christians should worship, fast, and pray to make better choices. Let me say that again. Christians should worship, fast, and pray to make better choices. Let's look at this brief video, and then we'll get into the Word.
Inilah bitakwa. As the prophets and teachers of the early church were fasting and praying, the Holy Spirit called Paul and Barnabas to go on their first mission journey. The church prayed together before sending them out.
Hands were laid on them. We prayed earnestly. As a united church, we prayed for their safety and that God would grant them the right words to speak to the multitudes. We prayed that our missionaries would be successful in spreading the gospel. Paul and Barnabas traveled to several places. In Cyprus, they proclaimed the word of God in the Jewish synagogues. In Pisidian Antioch, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. When the Gentiles heard their messages, they believed. The word of the Lord spread throughout the entire region, and the disciples were filled with joy and the Holy Spirit.
Paul and Barnabas appointed elders in every church and prayed with fasting, commending them to the Lord. They gathered the church together and reported all that God had done through them and how he had opened a door of faith to...
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. This undoubtedly was the most important part of time and life of the early church, because once again, the Mecca of what would become Christianity moved from Jerusalem to Antioch. And there in Antioch, God began to send prophets there. And as God sent prophets, a new ministry began to manifest itself. And if you know anything about me, I like new. I don't mind having stuff new in my life.
Amen.
Hello, somebody. I'll drive the car until it gives out, but a new car is a good experience. But this thing that was new in the text was is that place where a prophet came from, Jerusalem, began to become the Mecca of Christianity.
All right.
Oh, it became a new thing. So not only did it go from being a church that would receive prophets, but right in this text, we see how the church grew so well that they began to send prophets.
Come on, man.
Hello, somebody. And a lot of times you want to be a part of a church that's growing. And one of the things that a church that's growing does is a lot of times it raises up preachers and it sends preachers to other churches.
Amen.
I'm from a legacy there in Dallas. I came from under Dr. E.K. Bailey. Dr. E.K. Bailey had 150 sons in the ministry. And now we are sent all over the world, because of the work that God was doing there at Concord. Hello, somebody. God began to raise up folk and to send them out to impact the world. And that's the dangers of having a good church, the dangers of having a church that's on fire, the dangers of having a church that is in revival. You see, because that kind of church will not only impact its community, but it will raise up saints and believers that will go out and impact other community and other churches.
Amen.
Hello, somebody. And that's a big deal. But we see that the first time that this happened in that church, it happened right in the midst of worship.
All right, somebody.
For the Bible says, while they were worshiping the Lord, while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit set apart. Hello, somebody. Don't you know that's why it's dangerous for Christians to miss worship on Sunday, because God begins to work and move in the lives of Christians while we are worshiping. God may want to move. God may want to speak. God may want to do some miraculous things in our lives.
Neighbor, call me. That you come here to worship this morning. You see, if you come in here and you leave the same way you came, that usually means that you didn't worship. Hello, somebody. If you come in here and you didn't hear from the Lord during the worship service, that means that there's probably something wrong with you. You didn't worship this morning. Oh, you paid too much attention to Sister Sally's suit and what she had on. Oh, you paid too much attention to Mr. Grumpy up in this place. If you didn't hear from the Lord this morning, it's because you did not worship. Say to your neighbor, we come here to worship. There are many people in our day and time come to churches for many different reasons. Some people come to make business contacts. Some people come because it's a family thing. Some people come because it's a clique. You come here to clique with your friends. But there's some people who want to be used of God and by God. There's some folk who know the God that they serve. And when they come in this place, they come to worship. If we want him to move, if we want him to save our church and cause revival to come in this place, we've got to be about worship. There was somebody in the survey concerned that we need to grow. Let the pastor say we don't need no more members. Right. Because I can't pastor members. We don't need to grow that way. We need more disciples. It begins in worship. Because after they worship, God calls some folk out. And when God calls some folk out, the word began to spread. That's what you'll see throughout this book, that the word began to spread. He didn't say they left the church and gossip began to spread. Hello, so did you see what happened in services, Mom? Did you see her? No, it wasn't about the people. When they worshiped God, the word began to spread, and people began to get saved, and the church began to grow up disciples. Hello, somebody. Say to your neighbor. You need to worship this morning. You need to worship this morning. That's the first thing the devil wants to get you to do as a growing believer. He doesn't want you up in this place. He doesn't want you amongst the saints. Hello, somebody. I'll be the first one to say that Bethlehem is not perfect, but I can tell you that Bethlehem is better than being in the world and allowing the devil to take advantage of you. Hello, somebody. I'd rather be in under the ark of the safety of God in an imperfect church than to be out in the world and don't have God's ark of protection over me. Hello, somebody. That's why the Bible says to forsake not the assembly together of believers. Hello, somebody. Because it is in worship where God begins to move. And in this text, in the midst of worship, God began to move. I hear David saying, that he wants to live all of his day, and I will live, I will stay in the household of the Lord forever. Hello, somebody. I will dwell in the household of the Lord forever. Psalms 23. And David wasn't just saying that. A good illustration of that is from 2 Samuel chapter 12, verses 20-23. And I shared this our Thursday when we talked about I must go to Layla, at the funeral site there. We see David in this text in turmoil. David in this text was crying that God would save his baby boy. David in this text, he was desiring for God to work and desiring for God to move. He was going through so much toil in this text that the people, when the baby did die, was afraid to tell David that the baby would then die because they thought that David was going to do something to himself. They thought of the Lord and worship and worship. He went into the household of the Lord and worship at his most down time, at a time where he felt forsaken, at a time that he knew God didn't answer his prayer, at a time where it seemed like that he would turn from the household of the Lord. Oh, he decided to come to the household of the Lord. And that's why I like seeing this young couple coming this morning. They came to the household of the Lord on Sunday. Hello, somebody, to worship God. Oh, to worship God. Go ahead and give God a hand clap of praise. Widow had buried, oh, my father in the ministry, Dr. E.K. Bailey. Oh, it was a sad time. It was a time where it was a bit unsettling because, in that place, for the first time in my life, I saw masses of preachers crying, and that put me off. That was unsettling to see all of those men of God crying. Oh, in our church was mourning and crying. Oh, but sister, oh, Sheila Bailey, oh, that next Sunday she showed up in the household of worship, even after she had lost her husband. Yeah. Hello, somebody. Oh, you better learn how to worship him. Oh, in tears. Oh, you worship him in the good times. Can you worship him in the bad times? That's what, oh, Brother Joe had to say. Oh, should I not, in Eton's translation, should I not worship, oh, God, in the good and the bad times after he has given us the good times? And he told his wife, you must be a foolish woman to think that I'm not going to worship, oh, my God, in Jesus' name. Oh, somebody here today, you better learn how to worship. Say your name. And not only when is he worthy to be worshipped, oh, he does his best work doing worship. Yeah. Oh, and I couldn't help but to think, that we worship not only in the 11 o'clock hour, oh, but we worship during Sunday school when we open up the Word of God. Yes. And I can't tell you how many times on a Sunday morning that after we have had, Sunday school and went on through worship. Yeah. Oh, can I say that God spoke and that God moved beyond the shadow of a doubt. So there's some folk up in here, you better learn to increase your worship. You better begin at Sunday school because you might be missing it. Hello, somebody, in Jesus' name. Say to your neighbor, 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 I'm going to set aside Sunday morning for worship. I didn't just say, the 11 o'clock service. I said Sunday morning for worship. Yes, Sunday school in there.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody.
Yeah.
Talk about how to make the right choices.
Yes, course,
you won't be able to make right choices if you're not worshiping.
Amen.
You won't even be able to hear from God many times if you're not worshiping.
That was
well, people say, "Well, I don't need a church, to be a Christian." Hello, somebody. You're right. You don't need a church, but if you're going to be a disciple, you will need a church. Hello, somebody. Because the very meaning of a disciple is learner.
Right.
Hello, somebody. Man. And how can you learn on your own?
Right.
Oh, and in the secular world, how many lawyers represent themselves? And in the secular world, how many doctors operate on themselves?
Right.
Hello, somebody. None that have a good sense in their head.
Right.
Hello, somebody. So you need a worship.
Yeah.
Oh, so God can work on you. Hello, so God can tell you about yourself.
Yeah.
You out there by yourself. You get comfortable in your sin. But if you're in here, God will tell you about yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
Hello, somebody. And if you're a true Christian, you're going to grow. You can't make right choices without worship.
Right.
Hello, somebody. You can't make right choices without prayer. It says, the prayer of choices. Amen. While they were worshiping the Lord and what? Fasting.
Yes.
Hello, somebody. While they were worshiping the Lord and what? Fasting. You don't hear that much about fasting today. You probably won't hear that on the television about fasting.
All right.
Hello, somebody. And we are in a society where we really love to eat. Hello, somebody.
Yeah, right.
We have restaurants on every corner.
Well,
hello, somebody.
Right, yeah.
And if we don't have restaurants, we'll drive as far as Norman.
Come on.
Hello, somebody. We'll drive as far as Moore.
Yeah.
Hello, furs over there and more. That's a good furs. Hello, somebody. to get good eating. Hello, somebody. We'll go the distance. We'll go over there to Davis and get some of that good barbecue. Hello, yeah, Smokey Joe. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody.
Wow.
We'll make the sacrifice to go get the food.
Yes. Mom.
But we deny the food to get closer to God.
Come on,
right, right.
Come on.
Wow. We'll make the sacrifices to get the food. Hello, somebody. But can we make the sacrifice to deny ourselves and get to God closer?
Come on, right, man.
Yeah. Amen.
That's good, man.
Sacrifice.
To tell you the truth, some of you are going through too much to not be fasting and praying. And there's a difference, because sometimes we go through a bad time and we just forget to eat. I'm not talking about that.
Right.
I'm talking about where you set aside a time when you were going to fast and pray about what you're going through.
Yeah.
Man.
Hello, somebody. Wow. Hello, somebody. That's the reason why. Every third Wednesday before the fourth Sunday, we set apart a time for our church to fast and pray from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. to fast and pray. Oh, because God hears our prayers. When we draw nearer and closer to Him, God hears our prayers. When He sees us sacrificing our bodies, God, hear our prayers. When we fast and pray, and that the church, that was about to make a huge decision, they were not only worshiping, but they were fasting. Hello, somebody. Ask your neighbor. Neighbor. When was the last time you fasted?
When was the last time you fasted?
Hello, somebody. Maybe you don't have the victory in your life because you're not fasting and praying.
Wow.
Hello, somebody. Mark chapter 9, verse 29 says, and He said unto them, this is the King James, this kind can come forth by nothing but by what? Prayer and fasting. They were trying to rebuke a demonic spirit that was about to kill their baby boy. The disciples were, and this man in the text, a little further up, he was one who believed. He said, I believe, but help my unbelief.
Right.
And Jesus had to tell him that in that text that with God all things are possible.
Yeah.
And then Jesus spoke to that demonic force that was throwing that baby boy in the fire, spoke to that demonic force that was throwing that baby boy in the water, trying to kill him. He spoke to that demonic force, and He told him to come out. There's somebody here today. You're going too much. The devil's trying to kill you with the fire. The devil's trying to kill you with the waters. The devil's trying to kill you with the circumstances of your loss, through your trials and your pain. The devil's trying to kill you, but you better learn how to fast and pray and rebuke that devil from your life as well as the life of your children. Hello, somebody. Give God a hand, have a praise. We're not just building that building for us. We're building that building for your children's children. And the devil's trying to take your children out. The devil's trying to take your grandchildren out. And you better learn how to deal with the devil. Hello, son. The only way you can deal with the devil is you've got to fast. in prayer. And Jesus said to your neighbor, you better fast and pray right now. You're going through too much. You need to fast and pray Monday. You need to fast and pray Tuesday. You're going through too much. You better fast and pray. Your children are going through too much. You better fast and pray and rebuke that devil out of your children's life, out of your children's children's life. In Jesus' name.
Man.
In Jesus' name. This kind comes out by fasting and praying. And parenthetically, I teach and preach to single folk at the beginning of my career. And that single folk who desire to live for the Lord. They say, I'm having trouble in my sexuality. My body takes over, and then my mind follows. And then they ask, how can I live holy and pure in a culture, in a society like we live? And then some people give out trite answers like, you can go and take a cold shower. Hello, somebody. No. Cold shower ain't gonna help, no. Hello, somebody. You know what helps? Fasting and praying. Denying your body. Hello, somebody. Your body ain't supposed to tell you what to do. You're supposed to tell it what to do. And the way you do that is you've got to fast and pray. I give a good illustration about how, have you ever noticed that on Survivor there are not a lot of couples on Survivor? Survivors where they need people on the island and then they can't eat and they can't. The number one thing that they have on an island is an appetite, and when their bodies are being not fed, they ain't concerned about their sexuality. Because starvation is the number one, eating is the number one need. Hello, somebody. Fast and pray, single folk, if you want to live holy. Fast and pray, married folk, if you decide, to stop stepping out and you want to change your life for the best. You want to live holy, church. God is calling us to be holy. God is calling us, as we learn in Sunday school, at the Jordan, the ones that got to go over were the ones that were obedient to the words. All them others, hard-hearted, stiff-necked folk, didn't get to go into the promise. It was those who were obedient that got to go into the promise. And God is saying to Bethlehem, I want you to be obedient. I'm going to do this for you, but I want you all to be obedient to the word of God. Oh, we should have had that on the survey. How many of you obey the word of God?
Come on.
Hello, somebody. How many of you are in obedience to the word of God? Are living a lifestyle that is holy? How many?
Good question, man. Good question.
Would it be almost 100% like some of those questions?
Right.
Hello, somebody.
Help us.
God says, I want you on one accord, and I see that you're struggling, and I'm giving you the answer right now, to elevate your Christianity. And the answer is, number one, worship to make better choices, and number two, to fast to make better choices. Take your neighbor, you got to worship and fast to make better choices. Amen, and praise the Lord.
That's a good clue.
At least I keep us strong. Talk about the placing of the choices. And it says, so after they had fast and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. This happened after they fast
and prayed. Yes.
Tell somebody. See, the sending happens after fasting and prayer. Some of you are looking for an answer from the Lord, but it's only going to happen after. Hello, somebody. You fast and pray. We want to build this building, but it's only going to happen after. Fasting and pray. Hello. We want revival. Some people say, we need more attendees. This is going to only happen after. We fast and pray.
We got
hello, somebody. I'm not trying to be religious, from the call of the church to fast and pray.
Yeah, it's been obedient.
In 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Tell somebody. I'm really desiring and praying that we as a church, oh, be able to call on the Lord.
Yeah.
Oh, to multiply us with disciples.
Yeah.
Oh, because after all, our vision here is what? Bethlehem! 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 We are to share the love. We want to be like this church in the text where the gospel went forth. And it talks about the gospel going forth. We want to be that kind of church. Yeah. We're not just building to build. We're building to build a congregation.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody. Yeah. We're building for more disciples.
Yeah, exactly.
Amen.
Hello, somebody.
Amen.
Hello, somebody. Yeah. Hello, somebody. Every Sunday, they're in town. They can show every Sunday. You see, we're not ready for disciples.
Yeah.
Hello, we're too small for disciples. Hello, somebody. But a member, like I said, a member might take the summer off.
Yep. Hello, somebody.
Pastor, Pastor.
It's too hot.
Where is such and such and such? And I said, well, they told me they were going on vacation. And then somebody said, well, I saw them at Walmart. They ain't on vacation. But I said, oh, but yes, they are. They're taking the summer off. I'm so glad that God doesn't take the summer off for me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm so glad that he doesn't take any summer off. Does the devil take the summer off?
No.
Hello, somebody. Why do Christians think they can take the summer off from church? Hello, somebody.
Say,
but Reverend, I'm trying, okay? Do they have churches where you're going?
Hello, somebody.
Yeah. Let them mess with them.
Yeah.
Do they have churches where you're going? Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. You go travel, you're going to find the food.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody.
Yeah.
Let me say that again. I'm mellow a little bit.
Because
anywhere I go in America,
right.
I know somebody that can tell me where it's a good place to eat.
Yeah, you're right.
Hello, somebody. Right. And they say, yeah, Reverend, you need to go over there and try this something.
Mm-hmm.
Or that.
Yeah,
right. What about spiritually?
Come on.
Where can I go even when I'm on vacation to get a word from the Lord? I need a word from the Lord as much as I can.
Right.
Hello, sir. I need it Sunday.
Yeah.
And I need it Wednesday.
Right.
Sir. I need the word.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody.
Yeah, yes, sir. Yeah.
But before God works and moves, there's fasting and praying.
All right.
And then after that, they have a choice. That they placed their hands on them and sent them off.
Yes.
Hello, somebody. That means that there was answered prayer.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody. But it happened after worship. It happened after fasting. And then there was the placing on the hands.
Yeah.
Hello, somebody. God wants to place some hands on some folk up in here today.
Amen.
All right.
As a matter of fact, he wants to place the hands on all of us here today.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
So that when we leave this place, the word can spread.
The word. Yeah.
When we leave this place, the gospel can spread.
Yeah.
But when we leave this place, the love can spread. Bethlehem!
Bethlehem!
Bethlehem! Bethlehem! How are we going to share it?
By living it and giving it.
By living it and giving it. How to make the right choices in life.
Yeah.
All eyes closed, heads are bowed, saints are praying. Deacons, will you come?
All right.